I was about to ask that question. There's good cholesterol and there's bad cholesterol.
No, there's one cholesterol. There's different carriers. But what they're talking about is like an LDL. All right, LDL is a low-density lipoprotein. Did you hear cholesterol in there?
I heard protein.
You heard protein, right? Okay, well, that's what it is. It's a little protein sac because if you think about it, our blood is water. Cholesterol is kind of a fat and they don't necessarily mix. So the body had to have a way to move this stuff from the liver out to the tissues where it's needed. So they make this little thing called an LDL. And we look at when you look at a certain test, like we're going to talk about this NMR test, which is for the cholesterol, and it'll show you how many of those little particles or little boats you have that float around and take care of this stuff around. Because an LDL cholesterol count, when they look at it, what you're looking at is carrying cholesterol, is carrying triglycerides, is carrying other fatty stuff you need for like cell membranes, things like that. So that's all in that LDL.
And if you've noted, he's mentioned the word need a few times.
Yes.
Cholesterol is needed by the body. Yeah. It is not something that is bad. Even the LDLs, it's not all right. Bad. You have to have it, like he said, for cell membranes. You have to have it for brain function. You have to have it. But it's when it kind of gets out of control, I guess, is when there
that's
could
the
be a problem. What we like to look at and is the NMR. And it's an MRI of the blood.
Yeah.
So it gives you more information. I have seen people with extreme high cholesterol, even extreme high LDLs, and they're fine. But their HDLs are usually good. Their triglycerides are good. Their particles are low. They have a lot of other factors that make that cholesterol not damaging to them.
And when she says that HDL is good, okay, what she's not
and
talking about
HDL
is just
particles.
A number.
Right.
Okay, like, oh, my HDLs are real high. It doesn't mean anything. That what you have to look at is that HDL functional?
Right.
And that NMR testing, it's nuclear magnetic resonance, what it'll look at, like she said, it's an MRI of the blood. So you can actually see these particles and see if you've got enough HDL particles to actually do the job. You can have really high, we see this a lot, high HDLs and low HDL particles, which means it's a dysfunctional HDL.
Right. So it means that if you think your good cholesterol is really good, some people's is not.
Yeah.
So that's what you have to look at. You got to get deeper into what do you really have? Not just cholesterol, which is a calculated test.
Before we get into the testing, what can you do before we get involved in coming in for testing on an everyday basis that helps keep that cholesterol in check?
Well, it depends on the person because actually 70-80% of your cholesterol is made in the liver. Most of it is genetics. So yes, you can eat better and you can do a real food diet, get off packaged processed food, get off of seed oils, because seed oils are definitely things that's been shown to actually make really bad lipids. So, you know, that's something everybody should do anyway. But even doing that, sometimes your genetics can overcome that, which is when you do need something to help. Mm-hmm. So that's what we kind of get into with testing is what kind of underlying genetic factors do you have? And if you do have them, I have people that come in that think they have it in their family, but they think I've been good. I'm actually not overweight. I'm active. I'm healthy. And when you do their lab work, it is a mess. So their genetics have actually overcome what they're doing. So they have to take some stuff to actually get it in check.
Yeah.
But you can. There's things that you can do. That's why we're telling people about it, because there's things you can do to prevent depending on which one it is.
Took my test and I was bad in the good and good in the bad. These are things that you can correct.
Yes.
Correct.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
So that's why we tell people have it checked when you're younger, and that way you can do something about it before it causes a problem.
Well, about younger, but,
and I say 50, and I mean 50 is just kind of your, after 50, you absolutely need to do it. But honestly, we have people younger and younger keep coming in wanting to see their risk factors.
There's also lipoprotein A, oxidized LDL, A1C. Let's get into those.
Well, you know, when you look at this NMR, I mean, that gives us an overview of how your cholesterol is actually structured. The number of particles, the size of that particle, we can actually measure it, okay? So many nanometers. Now, that's a millionth of a meter, okay? So it's not very big, okay? But that they can actually measure these things. So we see all the risk there and what needs to be changed in that respect. But then you get into things like, and if you're on Facebook, here for some reason lately, there's been tons of stuff show up about the Lp(a), and it's a lipoprotein A. And what it is, it's another one of the, if you will, part of your cholesterol picture, and pretty much genetics, okay? And they say about, you know, 20% of the population so far that we know has this Lp(a) issue, and it really produces a lot more cardiovascular problems, heart disease, and so on. So it's something that needs to be checked. It's part of our super cardiac panel. I mean, everything we're talking about today is part of that panel. Okay, so it is the NA, we'll start with the NMR. But then you get into that LP little A. You got to know where it is. And because there are things you could do that, even though it's genetic, you can manipulate it a little bit.
And there's things, some amino acids that you can do to block it.
Block
your proline and lysine actually block the receptor sites and makes it not as bad for you. So there are things that you can do if you find it. There is the oxidized LDL.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, when you have high oxidative LDL, you need antioxidants. So your regular things that lower cholesterol don't touch the oxidation on the cholesterol. It actually, they have found in some cases that some of the statins can increase the oxidation on the cholesterol. So you want to do something totally different. I mean, that's actually, so if you know you have that issue along with it, there are different antioxidants that you can do. But you have to test it to know where it is.
Yeah, and you know, the reason it's so important, and I've looked through the research, and you dig back 20, 30 years ago, they knew about the oxidized LDL, but has your doctor ever mentioned oxidized LDL to you? No, I promise you. And there's a problem with that, because oxidized LDL shows up in what? Cardiovascular plaque. Okay, so in other words, plaque is the stuff that causes the heart blockages, right? And it shows up there. The stuff that's stuck in there is oxidized LDL. Oh, why aren't we talking about that more? Well, we really should. And it's overlooked, it's kind of ignored. And unfortunately, that's the stuff that's going to get you. And back to her comment about seed oils. Horrible.
Yeah, seed oils are horrible
for oxidation. And that's vague oxidizing. They wind up in that LDL particle, and bingo, you got a problem. So that's why that test is so valuable. It really is.
What about A1C? I hear that a lot on television.
Well, yeah. A1C is so important on cardiovascular risk, because what that's looking at is your 3-month blood sugar average. And we know, just from all the research out there, if you are pre-diabetic, diabetic, or even insulin resistant, it increases cardiac risk greatly. So I tell people that come in that just their A1C is high. Without even doing any of the cardiac tests, you're at cardiac risk. Because if you don't get that sugar down, you're damaging the inside lining of the arteries. And when the body damages, what the body does when there's damage is lay down plaque. So when you're damaging things with the sugar in your body, then it's going to increase plaque buildup. So again, that just shows if your A1C is high, then it is a cardiovascular risk factor.
No doubt about it.
And another thing that we see along with people that tend to have high A1Cs, it almost goes hand in hand, and I mean 90-something percent of the people, high triglycerides. And triglycerides are checked on the NMR, but people with high sugar tend to almost always have high triglycerides. So, and the way you lower them is you change your diet and you get off of carbs and sugar and things like that.
Yeah, you know, the starchy carbs are especially bad, you know, and of course the sodas, obviously, high fructose corn syrup, et cetera, et cetera. And it's, you know, they've got so many names. I think there's like, I saw not too long ago, there was like 260 names they have to hide sugar in.
Yeah.
Well, how in the world are we supposed to keep up with 260 names? We can't. So, you know, if you eat real food, it doesn't have this stuff hidden in it, you know. And that's the key that, you know, like she talked about, real food. You know, people ask us what kind of diet we run. Real food. And it's, you know, but when you look at it finding out about, you know, what are your risk factors? That'll tell you, like, okay, what kind of a diet might you do best with? You know, because if you've got, you know, what we call familial hypercholesterolemia, in other words, your family's just got cholesterol off the chart, you know, it looks like something Elon would take to the moon, you know, and when it does, if you've got something like that, well, okay, you really probably don't want to do that carnivore diet. Because there's a strong possibility, looking at some of the other factors, that it might just not work out well for you.
Right, it could make it worse. And people that have the APOE genotype 4, the 4 genotypes don't do good with keto diets. So like I said, there's a lot of different things that you can look at to see, you know, which diet might be best for you.
Right.
But in the meantime, if you don't know which diet's best for you, just get off of packaged processed foods, stay away from high sugar, because sugar, again, I can't say is probably the beneficial for anybody.